All we want to find out is how apes rose.
Well, it began in our prehistory with the plague that fell upon dogs.
And cats.
Hundreds and thousands of them died. And hundreds and thousands of them had to be destroyed in order to prevent the spread of infection.
There were dog bonfires.
Yes.
Do you expect me to talk?
Hello, and welcome to episode 196 of Do You Expect Us to Talk? I'm Becca, and as always, joined by my fellow co-hosts, Chris and Dave. We also welcome our special guest, Charlie Brigden. How are you all?
Good evening, folks.
Hi.
Hello.
Very enigmatic.
And hello,
well,
Charlie.
This is riveting.
Well, I said hi.
Did you? Yeah. To be fair, I wasn't listening.
Maybe you were doing an impression of the three astro apes when they arrive on Earth.
We're off to a flyer.
And they're all a little bit
yes, because that was intentional. Yes, yeah.
Yes, absolutely.
Well, that would make one of you Kim Hunter, so you can decide which one is which.
I'm happy to be Kim Hunter on the basis she's great in this film.
Yeah, we're just all just sipping on grapefruit juice plus.
Well, yeah, basically, I'll be really good and very drunk.
That's on grape juice plus.
And knocked up. No, I don't want that bit.
See, it's kind of odd that, like, Kim Hunter kind of did, like, the best piss acting while dressed as an ape. It's really odd.
She managed to emote through the moth.
More or less. I mean, you do see... There is a lack of articulation around the mouth. They can't really help that. It's not really a criticism, but there's a bit in the film where she's sort of side onto the camera talking, and like the mouth isn't really moving. There's just the slightest movement, but you know, it's best they can do. I do wonder how much the sort of cutting budget might have affected some of that, because we're now down to a budget of 2.06 million. So we're just over a third of the budget from 3 years before. So they have cut their cloth accordingly here, though of course there's going to be a little bit less in sort of set building and all the rest of it because of when it's set. But before we get to that, Becca, what are we covering tonight?
Tonight we are continuing our review series on Planet of the Apes, and we are discussing Escape from the Planet of the Apes, starring Roddy McDowall, Kim Hunter, Natalie Trundy, Bradford Dillman, Eric Braeden, Emmett Walsh in a very early role, Selma Neu, and Ricardo Montalban, and also Norman Burton, aka Felix from Diamonds of Forever. The score by Jerry Goldsmith, the script by Paul Dean, directed by Don Taylor, and released in 1971.
They've got a sort of.
They've missed out a huge swathe of the cast, so apologies.
We'll get to whoever we need to talk about. We've got yet another, before we go into the sort of making of it, which I was going to talk about a little bit. Third change of director in three films. So we've got Don Taylor this week, who was an actor and director, just chatting offline with Charlie. Film-wise, best thing he's probably known for would be the second Omen film, Omen 2, Damien, from 1978. He also did The Island of Dr. Moreau and a few other things, but he's also known as an actor, so he was in the original Father of the Bride. And various other things. I don't know him particularly well, even with a picture of him. I'm struggling to place him. He'd have been about 50 around the time this film was being made. We've got a change again. In terms of cinematographer, we've got Joseph Biroche this time. Hugely long career, including It's a Wonderful Life. He lends that. A little known film later in his career. Yeah. He did Blazing Saddles and The Towering Inferno.
Quite varied.
And then he did the two Airplane films. So
he's got sort of comedy, drama,
all over the place.
Creature features, everything.
Absolutely. And of course on the music side, because we do talk about this each week, Jerry Goldsmith is back. Very different score from the first film. Definitely. Again, very, very cheap film. Some of its needs must, and I think some of it is budget. I wouldn't be surprised if they tried to find a way to get us back to then present day anyway. because it's cheaper to do that. It's a bit like when we talked about the making of The Godfather and they wanted to shoot it in the period the film was made in to save money, and there was a big fight over that, because as soon as you start putting period detail, period costumes, or at least bespoke and sets in, yet the price goes up. But of course we do have that ending to Beneath the Planet of the Apes, which was the attempt to sort of close the series down, really, to shoot themselves, almost shoot themselves in the foot. But they found a way around it, which took me by surprise the first time I saw this, because I vaguely remembered seeing Planet of the Apes films where it was set present day. And I thought, I must have imagined that. And then, of course, I go through the box set, and by the third film, there they are. So, Charlie, you know this film fairly well, I'd have thought. Obviously, you two haven't seen it, have you, before watching for this?
No, I haven't.
No, this series, apart from the newer films, like these first Planet of the Apes films, is the first time I've seen them ever, especially for the show.
Yeah, okay. Charlie, what's your background with this film? Just, again, one of the group, really. Was it a standout to you when you saw them?
Not originally, but kind of when I saw them again as an adult, when I kind of ordered a big expensive DVD box from America, the one that had the Statue of Liberty on the front of the cover.
Which I got for a fiver, so clearly that was a different year.
that was back when it was big. It was really difficult to get DVDs from America, and it just it immediately stood out as a completely different take, but a really, really good one, and it still stands out.
I don't know what I think of this film in that I know what I think of it, but in terms of its conception, I don't know if I think it's really brave or really almost cowardly. It's like, oh, let's just do it in the present day and knock out a cheap sort of film. But there's something a little bit brave about this, because the first two films did pretty well and they've completely changed the format. This is now a very different film. It's not sci-fi in the same way. Its tone is notably lighter. It's hanging the film on a couple of supporting characters from the first couple of entries. It's returning in a leading man who wasn't actually in the second film. So I suppose there's an element of risk in this, and there are very few big stars in it.
Yeah, I kind of felt watching it. It was almost like in a really weird way. It felt like the logical next step, because this is kind of like the what if of doing the first film, but in reverse. The apes find themselves back in present day Earth, and while it does feel like a completely different film, it still feels of a part of the franchise. It feels like the next logical step where you should go. So I kind of found it like odd that it was completely different in tone, but then really appropriate at the same time, I thought.
Yeah, it's a bit of a tricky one. I've seen this film twice. My opinion of it has changed each time I've seen it. That sounds really bad. Also, I saw the trailer, and I thought, oh, it's going to be quite silly, obviously bringing them to what was then sort of present day, sort of 70s California. And I sort of thought, oh, sort of dressing him up in modern day clothes, and you sort of see clips of like during the court scene where they're like, oh, does he talk as well? And he's like, only when I let him, sort of thing. And sort of drinking copious amounts of wine, and things like that. And I just thought, oh, it's gonna be one of those films. But the ending just completely fooled me. So obviously, I sort of watched it again. My opinion of it has changed a little bit. There's such a sharp contrast between like the 50 minutes of fame and the really stark, well, the depressing ending. I think for me so far, this is so far it's the best film in the series for me. So, yeah, that's kind of long and rambling. So well,
let's go on to the thoughts then. So I would agree with that.
So I'm just going to push forward. Sorry.
No. From my perspective, I completely agree in that I liked it completely unironically. I don't know if it looks. impressive, cheap or what, but the end effect is like it's at once a light film with but with some interesting ideas, themes, interactions, a decent script. The two leads are just exceptional, particularly, well, both of them, but Kim Hunter, if I had to single one out, is like really emotive in the suit. Her body language is terrific, her sense of intelligence, the warmth between the two of them, that selling them as like a really loving couple as well. But at that comfortable stage of a marriage, you know, that stage that you just mentioned, you know, do you talk only when she lets me? That's not a resentful marriage. That's like a warm and easy ambiance several years in.
Many couples can probably relate to that as well.
Yeah, and I think
many years on,
I think Eric Braeden's character Otto Haslein is sort of notionally the bad guy in this film, but until a particular scene late in the film where he does sort of sneer and smirk, he doesn't play as that. He's just got an agenda. And his conversation with the president at one point about the threat they do or don't represent, it is really well thought out and really well written. Paul Dean's script guy, who obviously we've talked about before, wrote, Goldfinger would be sort of best known to us, but he also wrote the 1970s Murder on the Orient Express. He wrote The Taming of the Shrew, the 67 sort of Burton Taylor film, and The Spy Who Came In from the Cold, amongst other things. So it's really accomplished. It's got a score that sort of plays light, fun, fairly comedic, but the film is much, much more than that. And to me, yeah, it's not the sort of epic the first one is. It's not the expensive sci-fi the first film is, comparatively. Although we did talk about that not being as wildly as expensive as it could have been. But, I mean, it's certainly pricey compared to this. But it's the one that makes me think most. It's the one that makes me smile most. And it's the one that uses its running time most effectively so far. That's it from me as an opening thought.
Yeah, I kind of agree. I really enjoyed my time with this as a at first and only watch. I found it solidly engaging. I think the real key to this is like it's mostly character development. A lot of it, you are just engaged with the main characters and the situation, and you find like the story kind of slowly just evolves naturally. So it starts off very light in tone, and it feels very sort of a little bit tongue in cheek, very sort of, you know, it is funny, but not in a sort of that kind of like overtly joke. You know, it's just like the little sort of human touches of the situation, particularly with like Kim Hunter and like, you know, introduced to champagne for the first time and like, you know, getting dolled up and sort of and kind of enjoying like the fame aspect. But then it does find itself going to like dark places, you know, as it naturally evolves. So I think it's actually really, really well developed, and I think it's just like a really solid natural story to me.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's kind of, I mean, the, coming to it, where do you go from the end of the last film? It's kind of, so I think to kind
a
of
musical.
Almost.
Well, you had to, they did that in The Simpsons, didn't they?
Exactly. Let's do that.
You can talk. I can sing.
Yeah, every time they go, I can talk, I just want to go, I can sing.
Yeah. I would say porn. I would say like porn, but given they're all apes, like, maybe not.
No. Oh, it was Earth all along.
So anyway, we've just interrupted Charlie.
They made me a monkey out of me.
Let the man speak. I mean, admittedly, I interrupted, but I'm going to blame
them. I'm going to mute myself.
No, carry on.
Yes, so I think resetting the timeline like that is kind of a stroke of genius, really. And especially kind of, I guess, showing creativity inside the limitations of budget. And again, remember, this was in the days where they didn't spend more on each sequel. It was kind of less, more diminishing returns, really. And then also taking it back to the original, well, the Planet of the Apes novel, with the where the apes were in a much more modern setting, and it was much more satirical than the film ended up being. So that's a nice touch, and kind of it's nice to have Cornelius and Zira, who were both in the background for most of the films, and obviously Cornelius wasn't even in the last one. Well, not Roddy McDowell's Cornelius anyway.
Yeah.
Standing Cornelius. So to have those characters as the lead was quite a brilliant choice as well. And to have non-human characters as the lead is quite a bit of a dare as well.
Because they are the lead. They're not just the curiosity, the plots hanging around.
Absolutely. And I think they pull that off really well. And again, it's a typical of the Planet Apes film, because kind of it's a lot of fun and it's a good ride, but then the end kind of really takes everything out of you. And that ending, man.
I was surprised they went there. Well, I'm not. I knew they went there, but like I would have been surprised they went there. If you like,
yeah.
Knowing what I know now, the sort of big switch that we'll talk about later in the film is telegraphed. It's fairly obvious.
Yeah.
And we'll come on to that. It's not a flawless film, but it really doesn't need to be, in that we've got two. It's doing something different. It's cutting their cloth accordingly, which they either have to or no more Planet of the Apes. It's the only way. I think it's the only way to go because of the way the last film ended, but it's probably the only way to go anyway. What you do, another rinse and repeat, Taylor continuity figure. Yeah. There was nothing else to do unless you literally just keep remaking Planet of the Apes, you know? Never say Planet of the Apes again.
But also, I mean, it helps set up the next film as well, which is, again, one of the best of the series. So you certainly can't fault it for that.
Yeah, it's one of those classic. Yeah. It's one of those classic endings which has a sense of fate. Well, I was going to say fate. It's like, you know, it's it feels like a natural ending of, like, you know, of history being as it is being, that sort of nice sort of cycle. What the human, well, I say humans, it's only actually we driven by one character really, but what he tries to do into trying to, like, stop the end of the world actually effect causes it, so you can sort of see that coming in the next film.
We think unless it's that idea that time always sort of it is like a flowing river and it will always like readjust. This is meant to be, and you can change the circumstances and it will find its way back to what it was meant to be.
Yeah.
So I don't know if this is just like a complete sort of, you know, a robberous, if you like, never ending, never starting, or whether it is actually almost like the Back to the Future idea that they have changed history, but they've sort of changed it to the same thing. If that makes sense.
Yeah. It's like it's you know, the there is like the idea of destiny is like, you know, the ins and outs of how you get there might be different, but and the destination is still the same.
Yes, yeah. Exactly that sort of flowing river, stream, whatever you want to call it, idea. So yeah, it's I'm never convinced that, because at one point Cornelius tells them how it all happened. And he talks about the first ape to speak. And having not seen the last two for a while, I don't know if that is the first one that speaks. Do you know what I mean? I don't know if his history is exactly the same.
I don't know.
Because obviously we do have a talking... No, I think history has been rewritten. Because we finished this film with a talking sort of chimp surviving. Whereas in the original version of the timeline, they kind of evolved to be able to do that after they were sort of treated as pets, which is a few decades from this.
The timeline's a bit kind of out of whack from here, isn't it? I think, is it...
Next week is like 1991.
Technically it's the first one or something like that. It's all a bit wibbly wobbly timey.
Yeah, and I think also it's kind of treated as the first ape to be able to hurt, be able to talk or be heard to talk.
Yeah, I mean, we'll get to that next week, because obviously, well, very early on in next week's film, following on from this one, they're kind of hiding that ability. But we'll come on to that a bit later on. The only other thing that struck me is 1,000 times, yes, is a Ricardo Montalban quote that I've always
known. He's fantastic. For me, he's the highlight of this film.
He's not in it that much, actually.
Yeah.
But he's perfect for that sort of really enthusiastic caper.
He's very enthusiastic. And he first wants to be born in a zoo.
He kind of like just sort of, he sort of explodes on the screen. It's like, or suddenly, like, you know, you're watching a film. It's like, holy shit, it's Khan. But it's such like, he's such a, like a warmth presence. So you kind of go, with, you know.
Yeah, this is it. He's on the screen.
I'm not sure I did that, Chris.
He just exudes that kind of loveliness, really.
I didn't explode on the screen either.
He explodes with delight.
I mean, I was pleased to see him. Don't get me wrong. So
he has such a sort of a screen presence, doesn't he?
In
so
circus.
It highlights definitely would be obviously Kim Hunter and Ricardo Montalban, definitely.
Well, I don't want to do Roddy McDowell there down there. He's great.
He's pretty great too.
Fun couple they are, and they really love each other. When they're trying on clothes and stuff, the looks they're giving each other is just like
they do actually. So, yeah, they do work out as a couple. They do kind of really sell it. And yeah, they do kind of manage to emote through like the amazing sort of makeup as well. But yeah, I think, yeah, obviously them two as a couple, and then Ricardo Montalban.
Yeah. When she says at the end to, was it Dixon, Dr. Dixon, "You're only the second human I've ever kissed," I think he was quite wise not to quiz that too much.
Yeah, he actually doesn't have a line of dialogue.
I don't want to know what's happened there.
<He's> like, I won't go into any more detail, but...
I don't think you enjoyed it. Anyway, moving on.
Yeah. I just think he's like, Cornelius just sort of, and you're the first. And she's like, I got nothing else to kiss.
Yeah. You never thought they'd go all the way, though, did you?
No.
I did kind of wonder what he was going to do. I was like, okay.
No, they're really sweet, kind people. I know I'm making a joke.
Yeah,
no,
they do seem lovely. And
that was just lovely. The thank you.
They do
you
seem really genuine.
Yeah, absolutely. Shall we discuss this film sequentially, folks?
Yeah, it's only an hour and a half.
Well, yeah, we'll struggle to get to that on this show because there's not a massive amount to it, but we'll get to it anyway.
Well, yeah, that's part of that's a big plus on the side. Obviously, some of these films, as we later go on in the series, I mean, they might have a longer runtime, but they'll manage to fill all that time with essential material, and some might sag, some might be too big. But I think this hits it just right.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think it runs really well. And the start is the first establishing shot we see very much looks like the beach Taylor ends up at the end of the first one. I don't know if it's meant to be, but you don't immediately know till like a helicopter or whatever flies across that you're back in the present day.
Yeah, I think it's probably meant to.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, absolutely. And they found a spacecraft. Well, I say a spacecraft, that makes it seem alien. They found a spaceship, a shuttle, whatever you want to call it, NASA thing, in the water. They've pulled it to shore. Doesn't quite match with the first film because we saw Taylor inside that ship and it was bigger than it is from the outside, if you like. But it doesn't matter. The forces have turned up, ready to sort of welcome back Taylor, they think. And then they open it out. And the thing I wanted to note that I haven't really noted in the first two films is the way the apes walk. They walk like humans with a hint of chimp. Not chimps with a hint of human, not something weirdly make up. They walk fairly normally.
A little bit bowed, but still a bit of a galloping arms. A bit of a hop.
Yeah, and a bit of a hop.
Yeah, you can see that kind of one with evolution. I don't know if that's the word.
The thing that makes it
probably not the right word.
They take off, you know, welcome back Taylor or whatever, or Captain Taylor or whatever it is, and they take off their helmets and it's apes, and it cuts to like them looking a bit amused and sheepish, the military looking stunned, and the opening credits playing, and all I could think of was the end of Dad's Army when you get "You have been watching."
You have been watching.
Yeah,
it's a bit like that.
I'm not knocking it, but it just tells you you've got a very different scale of film.
They're like, well, they're put into the zoo, aren't they? Pretty much, straight from there.
They're taken to sort of be studied at the zoo.
Yeah.
by a couple of doctors. We've got Stephanie Branton and Lewis Dixon, both sort of fairly young doctors. And they're doing like intelligence tests, like coloured blocks and all that sort of thing. Which ones have I shown you before? That sort of thing. Zira pulls up a chair. They're bought oranges and they sit down with like plates and cutlery to try and cut it up. Immediately they're like, sorry to walk in on you when you're changing. And it's like, hang on, what are we doing? They brought clothes with them. So this is just causing general bafflement.
Yeah. Because they're
not quite sure how to behave.
They're keeping stump because, like, they think, well, if we talk, then everything's going to go shit. they're just going to panic and start asking questions, and we quite don't know what we're going to do yet. So they're deliberately staying silent. One of them is Milo, isn't it? The
Salmoneo, yeah. We were talking off air about this. Salmoneo was an actor, died about, well, the actor died about 5 years after this. He was stabbed in like a mugging, aged 37.
Yeah, it's horrible.
And he's invented for this film because I was trying to think where was he in the previous two? He wasn't. They've basically repaired Taylor's spaceship and sort of flown off as their world was being destroyed by a single bomb.
Milo was the one who kind of figured it out, so I think that he kind of, he's a character to explain, like, well, he's more of a scientist in that regard. He could figure out like how to like fix it and get off the planet, essentially, I think.
And they've gone back through this wormhole that was like, or time hole that was mentioned in the last film when they retconned that with Brent. And this doesn't really last very long in that they're tested a couple of times. She's really smart. They eat with knives and forks. They dress themselves. And as Milo is sort of telling them to sort of not speak for a minute, because Zira sort of did, they're put in this next cage to like a gorilla or Clarence Beaks. I'm not sure which. Because this is obviously, it is a man in a suit. But and they're all like, well, at least they'll have company. In their time, they hate gorillas. And not only that.
Yeah, there's a social hierarchy there that the humans just don't know about.
Milo gets grabbed and his neck broken almost immediately. So he's out of the film.
Ooh. I got kind of quite excited. I thought, oh, Salmonet, brilliant. And then obviously he learned his fate. And I was like, oh, it's very, you know, very sad.
Yeah, it was fairly quick.
See, sad fun fact. Not so fun fact. About
yeah.
him.
Yeah, I don't know if this is to sort of almost bond the doctors to them, because the doctors come in, try and calm them down, and you end up with I like you and all that sort of thing. And there's a commission formed to investigate all of this and why there are like talking, you know, apes coming through in Taylor's ship and stuff. It's quite pacey, isn't it? Don't we go straight to the apes sort of going in and actually talking to them?
Yeah, so they're examining, and then and obviously they Zira gets frustrated because they're offering them like bananas, and they're like, we don't, because I don't like bananas.
<they're> like, I loathe bananas.
Yeah,
which apparently she does in real life. So, what she did in real life?
Potassium, yuck.
It's really good for you. No. I'll have vitamin C instead. Thank you. It's quite difficult to eat an orange with a knife and fork.
I've never tried it.
Because it'll go everywhere.
I've never tried it.
Well, it's me being a spaz, so.
I mean, you'd have to be a fool, wouldn't you? Be like a hot dog with a knife and fork or something. What fool would do that?
I mean, to be fair, there's no real easy way of eating an orange, really, is there?
I don't find it that difficult. I mean...
Well, yeah, but...
I can't imagine a podcast series on it, you know. But anyway, this is your area, Chris. This is Chris's
fruit corner. Yeah.
As I said, this is your fruity corner, Chris. Oranges, bananas. This is it.
Yeah. A subject I know next to nothing about. I know.
We've had nothing the past few films, so this is...
Yes.
Getting two of your five a day.
But, oranges and bananas. So, now that, yeah, so then they found out they're talking and that, and then don't we have a meet up with the president and his resident doctor or scientist guy, Otto.
Yeah. The president's a good guy here. Charlie made an observation before this because I couldn't place this guy. And in fact, even having looked him up, I was like, well, I recognise the name. That's it. Who is this president, Charlie?
He's, well, William Wyndon, the actor, was Colonel Matt Decker.
Right, and for anyone who's listening who doesn't know what that means?
That was an original episode of Star Trek.
Oh, Star Trek Connection.
Yeah, what was the episode?
The Doomsday Machine.
The Doomsday Machine, that's it. I actually asked that as a genuine question because I couldn't remember off the top of my head. He's also related to Decker from Star Trek The Motion Picture, the character anyway, that he's playing. So the captain in that film that Kirk comes and basically takes the ship back off.
Yeah.
You know, later to be a sex offender. The actor. Anyway,
everyone's not dodgy. Character.
He's very dodgy. Yeah, go and read up on him. He's really dodgy. What's the actor called?
Oh, Stephen Collins.
Stephen Collins, yeah. He turned out to be really dodgy. He only came out about 5 or 6 years ago. His career is now over. So, yeah, they've got this commission that are going to sort of basically talk to the apes. And they're introduced by their doctor, who's basically saying, you're going to meet talking apes now. And the commission's like, don't be so ridiculous. And when he says, which one's the female? And Zira stands up, he's like, how did she know to do that sort of thing? They must have followed a cue of yours. And this scene is just great. They're chained up to start with. And they tell the commission that where they've come from and that, but they don't say they knew Taylor. They're asked specifically, and they're saying that basically, I don't know if they go into like the fact that the chimps are peaceful. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, because they say we're peaceful. Can you take off these chains?
And the crowd, the crowd. It's not a football match, is it?
the audience is kind of, isn't it? It's a little bit, not quite. Obviously, you can compare this to the circus, I guess, media circus, compared with the actual circus later on in the film.
It's like a congressional hearing type thing.
Yeah.
Again, reflecting its budget, it's in quite a small little room. And then what do we go for? Do we go straight to sort of celebrity circus time? Do we go straight to all that?
They get their 15 minutes of
fame. Yeah, well, Zira, like, support note to Zira, like, kind of almost let slip that she did experiments.
She nearly says dissects.
Yeah.
And that'll come back to bite you in the bum later on.
It will. Although that scene is excruciating because they play it like they know she said something, but they don't quite know it's dissect. And they keep on at her and it's like, you know what she said. She knows
you kind of...
Yeah, it is a bit awkward, isn't it?
But at this point, you kind of feel like she got away with it. That they just kind of like, oh, okay.
Well, yeah, they glossed over it really quickly. So... Yeah, what next? They're taken to a hotel. I love that bit. They walk through the lobby. Your case, ma'am? I know it is!
it's just like... I think it's a kind of alien, you know, to us and to the apes as well. So, yes, it's my case.
It's more like the Naked Gun. Cigarette? Yes, I know.
That's my lord? No. That's a little bit kind of fish, literally. Well, not literally. I was fish out of water.
So we've got them basically in a hotel in quite a nice suite. And basically taken out to buy a load of clothes, taken to party.
70s decor, oh my gosh.
I know, they wear some rock.
Oh my gosh.
I put it on our Twitter feed today. You know, it was like, yeah, I don't know. There's something very sort of cricket club about it.
It's quite funny because I'm sort of going through all like the classic Doctor Who right now.
I was just about to say,
he's like very best dressed, but it's all kind of really bright. Colourful outfits, kind of bits of like silk and different colour, you know, different textures here and there, and it's just like an assault on the eyes. it's amazing. It's just really, you know, really brightly coloured. I just think it's fantastic. I always remember
like watching films like these. I just wonder why on earth brown and orange was such a popular as the
yeah,
sign.
It seems quite common in that era, doesn't it? I mean, we saw that in On Majesty's as well, obviously coming towards, you know, sort of 68, 69. I think like tan, brown, orange were very trendy colours because you see a lot of them in that film. And you think, why?
Sweating.
It was obviously just a trendy colour of the era, I guess.
Whenever you watch 70s stuff, they're always quite sweaty as well.
A lot of like nylon, a lot of like non-breathable fabrics.
That could be it. It's all like, you know, static electricity and sweat.
You see a bit of that in Anchorman as well. It was obviously because it's set maybe sort of a little bit later on, sort of 80s as well. But it's very similar, isn't that?
Anchorman is the 70s, I think.
It's yeah, sort of 70s, 80s, but kind of, you know, in that sort of time, you know. But it's a lot of that really kind of thick fabrics that don't really let the skin breathe as much.
Yeah, I know. Stink. Otto Haslein, the sort of president's advisor, is like, he's got them on the sort of radar now. So he's, you know, I don't know if when he talks to the president, I don't think it's yet, it might be. He's very concerned about, like, he's just concerned because at some point the human race is going to end. And we find out at some point Zira's pregnant. And a sign of the times, like, pouring her a load of alcohol is the way to deal with this.
Yeah, because I wasn't sure whether that was... at first I thought, blimey, that's a sign of the times. But then he's also like kind of trying to get information out of her, isn't he? So I don't know if he's like purposely lying to us. Oh, yeah, this is good for you.
Yeah.
Grapefruit plus plus.
Nothing better than fetal alcohol syndrome.
I was going to say, yeah, and obviously where, you know, she gets interrogated later on while she's drunk and he starts smoking in front of her. It's just like, what? I guess I don't know what health attitudes were in that time, but they kind of moved along.
They smoked in hospitals.
Yeah, I was going to say, I guess that was the sort of thing. You do see, you know, those sort of films.
When I was a baby and I had something wrong with me, nothing serious, but like, I don't know, let's say for argument's sake, you know, colic or croup or something like that. My mother was talking to her doctor, who was an older guy at the time, to be fair. But his advice to her as a doctor was put me in my like cot on top of the wardrobe and have a fag.
Oh God, what?
So that was doctor's advice in the '70s. And again, for North American listeners, we mean a cigarette.
Yeah, it seems like you have everything. It's just have a drink, have a smoke. It's like, what?
Yeah, and they were often told like glass of wine's good for you, that sort of thing. I don't think
red wine, that can be. You know, if you have like, I don't know, like half a glass a day or something like that, that does have help certain health benefits, I guess. But yeah, I just.
Whereas now they are, there is no safe amount to drink when you're pregnant.
Yeah, there's no quite strict guidelines now, aren't there? But it changes all the time, doesn't it?
Odd one won't hurt, but even then, very rarely do you see a pregnant woman who drinks. If she does, it's just not very much. So, but they're basically.
It just made me laugh. That's all. I mean, by no means health experts, but it just made me laugh.
Before the interrogation thing, she drinks champagne and she's like, but it's called Grape Plus Plus, isn't it? Or something like that.
It's like grapefruit juice.
Yeah,
grapefruit juice plus.
And she's asked what her favourite fruit is and she's like, grapes. And they all fall about laughing. It's like they're just a real curiosity. And like Cornelius is asked, what do you think of human women? What do you think of like women or something? And he's like, very human. And again, they're all laughing. They're like total celebrities.
Is that funny? But when she's in the bath, how is it soothing but very wet?
Yeah, it's wet and it's like...
You think?
Yeah.
And I saw that in the trailer and thought, oh, groaning. But actually, yeah, you know, I think when you contrast it and compare it with other sections of the film, I think it's really cleverly done. And what can be quite very serious, quite heavy film, as you know, a moment of levity that we can all enjoy.
Yeah, so Otto actually does go to see her at the sort of suite. We've established she's got a taste for champagne. He gives her more of that, goes to get a cigarette and then goes, oh, I best not in your condition. But it's actually a little recorder he sort of sets running and starts asking her questions as she gets drunk. And she tells him just enough about what they did and what the future is that he just gets really worried and wants to talk to the the president over it. Cornelius has sort of revealed to them all that, you know, the human race, he explains that it's basically It starts with a virus that kills dogs and cats. Apes sort of replace them as pets, and then because of their skills and dexterity, almost start becoming slaves. And then the sort of war was started by gorillas who fought back.
Mm.
And Housline is still not convinced that they're saying everything. But I don't know at what point he talks to the president. But I thought that was a really good conversation. What did you make of it, Charlie? The conversation between Housline and the president, where he's talking about this is going to happen in 2,000 years, and the president is like, well, I think our term will be up by then. But they have like a proper conversation about
it. Yeah, it's interesting because it's where you kind of see Housline almost himself having a bit of a dilemma, because there's no kind of definitive, because they don't paint him as just this straight evil kind of guy.
He's not evil at this stage. A bit later on, they push him slightly too far, but not at this point.
But here, he is actually being a scientist, but also kind of... It's interesting the way they contrast this with Dr. Zaius and how it works in ape time, where you have them talking about men in the same way. In terms of, especially Dr. Zaius at the end of the first film, where he talks about how men were responsible for the destruction of everything. And it has a similar kind of tone. But yeah, there's just the moments where it sets into motion what's going to happen. But at that point, you can see he's still on the fence.
The president is just basically saying, well, I mean, he starts off with the flippant remark, our term will be up by then. But he's actually making the point. It's 2,000 years away. We don't know what's really going to happen in the interim. We don't know that it's definite. And if it does happen, maybe they'll do a better job as a society in some respects, that, you know, maybe humans are meant to end at some point in the current way of doing things. But he does end up saying... Sorry, Chris, go on.
It's a surprising, like, philosophical, like, conversation that you'd expect, like... Because usually you used to sort of, like...
Well, we're setting... in the second sequel as well.
Yeah.
So I wouldn't have expected this sort of depth.
Yeah, you wouldn't have, you'd expect, like, the presidential chief scientist, and the president panics, goes like, oh, well, I'll just keep it under wraps and just goes along with whatever he says. You kind of expect that kind of conversation. But it's like, oh, there's actually some thought going on in here. There's even, like, biblical references where they're like, you know, where it's like, you know, does this work, or, you know... Should, you know, it's actually surprised me at, you know, like, at the time, but yeah, go on.
It's just the fact that eventually the president says something along the lines of, "I will abide by the commission's decision. If you have these worries, voice it to them, and I will abide by their decision." And it's just a bit thoughtful because it's not humans bad.
Yeah.
And then the commission effectively ends up saying, this is where they do reveal. They say that they're going to go to some facility to be interrogated more. I don't know if this is the point where they say they're going to be sterilized and the baby destroyed, because she's pregnant, Zira, as we just said.
Yeah, I think that's when they come to the decision. That's the ultimate decision, isn't it?
That's the decision afterwards, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because that's the bit where Otto grins, and I think, right, you've pushed him into bad guy at this point. To start with, they take him to, like, the facility just to question them. And I thought it was going to be a real rough interrogation. I suppose in some respects it is, because they drug Zira.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not like they're waterboarded or something. They start off with them quite... it's quite civilized to begin with. They just ask questions.
It still feels horrible, though, because you get the separation of...
Yeah, that kind of feels really bad. And plus, you've got a lot of, obviously, as we mentioned in previous reviews as well, sort of a lot of anti-war kind of sentiments going on as well. So there's kind of that aspect, there's kind of that subtext, I guess, to it.
Yeah, there's just kind of separated from Colleen. And you can, because you know she's pregnant, and you know, like, that they're not being 100% truthful. So they kind of want to prize information, and it just feels a bit. It just feels a bit. This isn't 100% what's the word? Ethical.
No, and then they drug her in a minute.
Yeah.
Oh, and you get this hot hole, what were you saying? And they keep playing the bit where she nearly says the word dissect.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a bit...
And it makes me laugh because they're talking like it's modern technology, because he'll say things like, play from 3 seconds, da-da-da-da-da-da, and it's analogue. He's going to hit a rewind button.
It's yeah, literally. Not... It's...
Yeah.
And Cornelius tells them all about what's going to happen.
And that's when we get the proper explanation about it being the sort of that makes me think of the sort of reboot, you know, the whole virus idea, although the virus is different in the new ones.
Yeah, he says the ape known as Aldo.
Is that the case in the later films? It isn't, is it?
No, it isn't, because it turns out to be.
I thought it might be. Sorry,
they have changed history.
It turns out to be their son. Caesar.
Yeah. I thought that, but I wasn't sure, because the fact that he's the protagonist doesn't mean that he would necessarily be the first person to speak in anger. So that answers our question. They are rewriting history, but they're rewriting history to be just a variant of the same thing.
See, I always thought that it could possibility with it being like a long period of time, you know, in Planet of the Apes, that like, you know, sometimes like, you know, it's like the actual facts of history kind of change somewhat, or is kind of blurred. So what is known as Aldo actually was Caesar. Do you know what I mean? Like, you know, it's always like Aldo is referred to as Caesar, you know, kind of thing.
Lister, cloister, Lister.
Yeah. But, you know, there's always that sort of element of time kind of blurring sort of the...
Stories.
Like the actual...
specifics people sometimes as well. You did get historical figures who were like composites of two or three different ideas. So yeah, it's possible, but if we take it at face value, this is they are rewriting history by being there, but they haven't in the humans' attempt to stop it, they're not stopping anything.
Yeah,
in fact, they're probably speeding it up.
Yeah, well, that's true actually.
Okay.
Or just kind of just pushing them off.
Especially how Hasline's guys are treating them.
Well, they're not fostering. Yeah, there's not.
Not trying to make good relations, are they?
Yeah, there's not going to be a trade deal anytime soon. Yeah. Okay.
Spoiler alert.
So they drug her. She does admit to knowing Taylor and all that sort of stuff. And she has to admit to Cornelius. She's told them everything. The council in the meantime ruled that the pregnancy's got to be terminated, the ape sterilized. And then they come to give Zira sort of food where she's shut away. And he's sort of patronizing them because she doesn't want to eat, and he's like, you know, but maybe your unborn wants to eat. And then he makes the mistake it's seeded earlier of calling them monkeys, which Cornelius says earlier, don't call us that, that's an abusive term to us. And he sort of smacks the tray away, but just something goes wrong. It's meant to be a little outburst from Cornelius, but when we get a reverse shot, they don't know this because they're running out of the room, but he's lying there dead. He's hit his head on something, this orderly. So I suppose it would at least be manslaughter, but it certainly wasn't deliberate.
Yeah.
Manslaughter.
Well, I don't know. Does it refer to the person who's doing it or the person it's to? I don't know. Is it manslaughter or rape slaughter? Which one are we talking about? Well, you're slaughtering man, aren't you? So yeah, it's still manslaughter.
Yeah.
It does strike me as like the most like feeblest death as ever. You know, it's like
it is really, because when you see it in shot, he literally just smacks the tray away. That's it.
Yeah, and he falls off, and then you have the shot of like this big gaping wound on the back of his head. You think, how the fuck did they push that?
I know, I'm looking at it, I'm thinking, did Guy Hamilton direct this or something? It's like, oh, that'll do.
Was there someone hidden in the corner, like, you know, wait, setting them up? Like,
Was he carrying a jug or something?
I think he's cut himself, like that, there's broken glass there.
Glass, yeah.
Either that, or he just had a red, you know, birthmark on the back of his head and we've misunderstood entirely.
So... Or you just had like a, you know, like a heart attack right there, and the whole thing was just a big convenience.
Yeah.
So yeah, they basically go for a run, essentially. They try to escape the vicinity, and they don't hitch a ride in the doctor's car, don't they?
They're picked up by the woman, aren't they?
Yeah.
Zira's hiding in the bushes because she's now heavily pregnant. And Cornelius sort of is flagged down by the woman, Stephanie Branton.
Yes.
And says what's happened. Then you've got Hasline sort of, you know, seeing the sort of corpse being brought out, sort of being covered from where this so-called murder's happened. But the president wants them alive and he wants like due process. In other words, don't go and shoot them. It's like any other case. We try them like anything else. So they're helped to escape, and they're helped to escape to Armando Ricardo Montalban. You know, and he's like, "Well, you helped us like,
yes,
a thousand times, yes,
a thousand times, yes."
And his weird zoophilia obsession with Zira.
He seems. I don't want to put sexual overtones on it because they aren't there, but he finds her a very fine and impressive creature.
Yes.
And, you know, says if mankind is to sort of fall, I can think of no better sort of creature. So she gives birth to a real human. I was about to say to a real human ape. There's no such thing. It's obviously they have a hold a baby chimpanzee, but at the same time,
can you imagine if they actually sort of like just dressed an actual baby?
Just put a little mask on it.
I did sort of wonder when they, you know, her pregnancy came up. I thought, obviously, I've seen the trailers, but prior to kind of, you know, reading about this film, I kind of thought, are they going to dress up, you know, are they going to apply makeup to a baby, or is it going to be
that? Would just,
how's it going to work out?
Wouldn't that make you think, just use your acting, Gary?
Durka.
Okay. So at the same time, Eloise, an ape in the circus, has given birth. So there are two baby apes. This is really signposting what's going to happen. Zira's son, she calls Milo, but for the doctor who died. And then basically knowing Otto asks, is basically searching for them. And Armando basically says they need to leave to be safe. And they're going to go and hide out in a shipyard in LA until they can return to the circus. That's the general idea. They'll come back one time. But they're told basically, they can't be taken alive. We know that. But before they go, Zira asks to say goodbye to Eloise and is shut in to that sort of little cage. And did any of us not know what's happened here?
I've seen the film.
No, I know you would, but like, what about you guys? First time, did you think she'll switch them? Or did you really not think about it?
I honestly didn't think about it, because it was just one of them like things where, like, because I didn't quite know where the ending was. I was watching it, like, kind of assuming...
Just taking it as it comes.
Yeah, I kind of assumed that, like, these characters would be in the next film, but then... You know, but then I wasn't sort of thinking about it too much.
Yeah, okay. So we're quite near the end now. They sort of go to this sort of... Well, what is it? It's a ship, isn't it?
Yeah.
They're kind of disused. They're on it by themselves.
Yeah, it's all disused.
Cornelius has a pistol, but Otto basically gets there and, you know, asks them to sort of freeze. And Azira, won't she... and hand over the baby, he shoots her and shoots the baby. Cornelius shoots him, but Cornelius is shot by a sniper. So basically, they're all dead. And that's it, really, isn't it? Until we cut back to the circus and get quite an effectively rocked shot of the baby that we think is Eloise's saying, "Mama." And it's obviously Milo. She swapped the babies. And that's it.
I think that's a nice touch there. Same as Chris, really. I think the first time I saw it, I just kind of let it go over, and then it wasn't until I watched it again I thought, uh-huh. So it took me a little while. But yeah, to it going, "Oh, Mama." At the end, I was like, oh!
that bit where he shoots Zira and the baby. I don't know what this was in England, but in America it was a G, which is basically the U.
I'll say it's quite a shocking ending. You mentioned, Charlie, like off on our chat thread that the series has like a monopoly on downer endings.
Yeah, it really does.
Well, fires countless shots into the baby.
Yeah,
horrible. Oh my gosh.
That's the real horrible bit that you just think, ugh.
I mean, you can't see it because it's just in like a shawl that's covered in a blanket. He's basically shooting it like a blanket, but we know, you know, the implication, we know what it is. Horrible to see Cornelius shot and fall because he's literally trying to protect his wife and child. Mm. I don't know if Cornelius knows they've been switched, quite possibly.
It's a U over here.
Really?
Well, I suppose it's not particularly graphic, but...
Classified in...
It might upset children.
May 1971.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Upsetting children, yeah.
Okay, it does seem pretty...
Star
Wars is a U and that's got amputations.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, don't get me wrong, I don't think it should be any
fantasy
more...
Fantasy amputations.
I don't think it should be any more than a PG in modern parlance, the whole idea of a PG is... There's nothing too graphic in this, but there are themes and ideas and maybe shots that like a parent might either want to check or be on hand to discuss with their children.
Yeah, it looks like it was reclassified as a PG for video when it came out in 1987.
Yeah, I don't think it's one you just put your kids in front of and go back out to the kitchen or whatever it is you're doing. I don't think too many would be super traumatised, but it's something you just want to be on hand for.
I mean, I saw it as quite a young child, though. And obviously I'm a very well adjusted adult. Absolutely. And yeah, it's just a really, really, really kind of down ending. And especially that you've just seen these characters over three films and really, really got to know them. I mean, I think like what you were saying about whether or not you could tell that she was going to switch the baby and maybe not being upset was kind of evident of how much people really kind of love these characters and certainly how good McDowell and Hunter were as those roles.
It is kind of sold quite well because she does try and make a connection by saying "Mama," but you know to the event, you know, in terms of like trying, so that it does sell the idea that
is a clue, because when she first meets Eloise's baby, she's trying to get it to say mama, and Cornelius is like, she can't, and all the time that they're sort of on the run, she's still doing that, and it is a clue she's talking to a switched child, not her own.
It kind of sort of makes you sort of think, oh, she's formed a connection to ancestry or some regards, that has a when she says when she stops to say bye to him, he kind of makes you think, well, why wouldn't she made a bit of a connection, but
no, it's a clue, it's not a giveaway, it's not, that's not the same thing, it is like you could watch it again and go, oh yeah, of course, that's all. But I mean, you know, we're looking at a film that's got sort of moderately enhanced interrogation, drugging basically. It's got taking advantage of a female by getting her drunk, not sexual advantage, but, you know, certainly advantage of her good nature. It's got proper discussions about not only the morality of what they're going to do, but the nature of where humanity's going, not in any great deep way, but just how much do we interfere with this? If we're not saying... Had they said it all happens in 10 years' time, that's one thing. But it's 2,000 years away. How much right do we have to interfere with that? As Charlie says, it's anchored by, like, two non-human leads. Obviously, the actors are, but two non-human leads that have terrific screen presence, wonderful chemistry. Kim Hunter, I'm trying to think what else I've seen her in, but she is an extraordinary physical actress.
Yeah,
certainly. Really, really good. I don't know that we're going to see much better than this. Certainly in this series, I've seen some of the other films she's in, but I can't place where. Like, I know the swimmers are really interesting, but Lancaster film. But I'm looking at a character, and I'm like, don't know where in that. She was in a street cast named Desire, Estella Kowalski, but I'm not actually sure I've seen it.
Oh, what? I didn't reckon. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, the 1950s version.
Yeah, with Brando.
Yeah, I'm not actually sure.
Oh,
I've
I didn't realise. Sorry, I just didn't put the two and two together. Apologies.
And then countless television appearances. Edge of Night, I don't know that. 113 episodes. Oh, it looks like a soap or something. But anyway, she's in this. She's just perfect. I think she's the best thing in the film. Her eyes positively dance. Her physicality is great. Her love for her husband is great. Her sense of humour is great. There's a bit where they're watching like an interview on TV with Otto Haslein, who's trying to explain regression, the idea of, you know, and he illustrates it through an artist drawing a picture of himself, drawing a picture of himself, drawing a picture of, and so on. And at the end, he says, you know, good night. And she responds to the TV. She says, good night. And they take a beat, and then the two doctors laugh at her, and she takes a beat, realizes she said something silly, and she laughs. But she laughs with like a physicality. I went to the gym this morning, which is irrelevant other than the TV was on, or there were TVs on.
Were they showing Planet of the Apes? No.
They weren't showing Planet of the Apes, and this will sound like an odd reference, but they just stick on like morning television where there's reruns and stuff. So sometimes you'll see news, sometimes you'll see Cheers, Frasier, that sort of thing. Man About the House was on. And Man About the House had George and Mildred in it. They spun off into their own sitcom. Youth of Joyce. That physicality reminded me of Youth of Joyce. Youth of Joyce had that as well. So a natural comedian not playing a particularly comic role. And that's really all I want to say. It's the one I've enjoyed most so far. I think because of its, you know, it's dated, it's not that expensive, et cetera, et cetera. There are people who watch this and find it a bit hokey, but I had a thoroughly great time with it. Can't wait for next week. That's it from me, folks.
Good night.
Yeah, well, you.
Good luck.
Now you say things.
Becca?
Oh, gosh. Yeah, I can't really add much more apart from the Youth of Joyce reference.
Did you get what I meant, Becca?
No, I do. I do sort of know who you're on about. I would agree. She does. Yeah, she does have that great deal of physicality. I think I gathered she had some problems with the makeup and the costume, so that required, and obviously, where the first film was shot during the summer and it was so hot. Subsequently, all the other films were shot during the winter, so they had to kind of, you know, had the chill and cold to deal with as well. Likewise. And you can see that perhaps there's a slight difference in the costume and in the makeup as well. But no, I think, yeah, definitely. I think the high points would definitely be sort of Cornelius, Zira, and their chemistry together. Ricardo Montalban, because he's amazing. But generally, I think this is, for me, so far going through this series as a newcomer to it, this is definitely one of the high points for me, for sure. It's short, fairly brief, or kind of standard, I guess, cinematic runtime is maybe as a result of its budget, but it moves along really well. It's quite paced quite well. There are some moments of sort of really serious social commentary, but they're contrasted with sort of moments of levity as well. It's so much so that it changed my opinion on the film. What else? Yeah, great cast, strong characters, good dialogue, really tight script. Grim ending, unfortunately, as is the norm in the series so far, so I'm learning. But no, otherwise, really enjoyed it.
Yeah, I kind of like the contrast of like kind of like the light start all the way to the really grim ending. But it has a really sort of...
it's quite the contrast, isn't it?
But I like the sort of sense of like of the poetic cycle of the end, you know, of the baby still surviving. Good way to end it. I think it's a very good sequel. Thinking outside the box, but also just feels very natural successor to the first film. Really, very entertaining. Storytelling, mostly done through character arc. I think the first 40, 50 minutes is pretty much them just potting around, you know, modern society, really. But yeah, it's probably up there with. I think I agree with Becca actually. I think it's probably my favourite of the three so far.
So what would happen if George and Mildred moved in next to Cornelius and Zira?
I smell a sitcom.
That's a spin-off we all need.
I could write that.
Actually,
I'd struggle though on the basis that Uther Joyce died in 1980 of liver failure.
The grave,
like CGI.
The last time I went to a charity shop, I bought George and Mildred the movie.
Am I being silly or did you get what I meant?
No, that's absolutely. Uther Joyce is great.
Yeah.
And no, you're being absolutely right. And Richard O'Sullivan as well was amazing.
Yeah.
And both kind of gone sadly. Although I saw
Richard O'Sullivan dead. I thought he was like he had a major stroke when he wasn't that old.
Sorry, I'm thinking of Richard Beckinsale.
No, Richard Beckinsale. So he died at 31.
Yeah.
Of a heart problem.
Richard
O'Sullivan is living in, I forget what it's called now. There's a retirement home that's for actors. I forgot his name, but he lives there. But he has for years because he had a debilitating stroke in like his late 50s or something.
I was going to say that sounds like a sitcom.
It does. It really. Every time I hear it,
there is like a sitcom about that, isn't it? There is a retirement home for.
Yeah. I momentarily laugh until Brinsworth I remember House. That they're there because they're like impaired and not very well.
Yeah, it's called Brinsworth House.
Mm,
Norman Wisdom lived there.
Norman Wisdom, that was the
other one. Alan Freeman, Thora Heard.
Yeah. I bet they all had Thora Heard on her stairlift.
Nick McManus.
I was going to say, did she have a stairlift?
The wrestler.
Who?
What, really?
Mick McManus.
Oh, I know Mick McManus,
gosh. All the greats. I bet they had a right laugh.
Alan Freeman was there as well. Yeah. So Richard O'Sullivan has been there since having a stroke in 2003, which was 17 years ago, which means he would have been about 59. So yeah, he's been unwell for a very long time. But yeah, he was man about the house, and it was followed by George and Mildred got their own show afterwards.
And then
their
film.
They made films of lot of them.
Was there some kind of trend sitcoms?
On the buses films.
Yeah, been turned into movies. What's going on?
Holiday on the buses.
Mutiny on the buses. Yeah. Stuff like that, yeah.
George and Mildred. Ah, Brian Murphy. That's it. Brian Murphy's still alive.
He was. I saw a picture of him the other day.
He didn't look that much different, does he?
No. An actress I'm friends with on Facebook, who was in a lot of Hammer Horror, she posted a photo of him.
Right.
Saying, because
he hasn't worked for about 8 years, which would be appropriate. Because, he's in something. A voice in an episode of something. And he did Holby. Oh, no, he's still working on TV by the look of it, occasionally. I forget the point I was making about that. But yeah, it was. they did loads and loads of like film spin-offs of stuff like that in the 70s.
Yeah.
But yeah, what did you think of the film?
It's good. I don't know if I say. It's very easy to watch, whereas certainly the first two, even the first film, is absolutely brilliant. It's not the easiest film to watch, whereas I think the lighter tone of some of this as well makes it very easy to watch. And it's all of it seems a bit less nihilistic, especially since since you don't have the lead character going somewhere, there's got to be somewhere better than there. It's a great film. Every time I see it, I enjoy it. It's just the performance is really good, especially obviously McDowell and Hunter. And it's sad because it's Hunter's last. I think it was her last go round.
Did she not do anything after this?
Not for Planet of the Apes.
Oh, sorry, yes, of course. Yeah.
But you see Roddy McDowell again in the next one.
Yeah. Roddy's son of Roddy.
Yeah.
Roddy Jr.
Son of Ploppy, the chair.
Pardon?
Black had a reference.
But yeah, and it's I love this.
Good morning, Mr. Ploppy.
And I think,
oh yeah, of course. Sorry.
Lonely nights must just fly.
Sorry, interrupted Charlie again.
Again.
Oh, rubbish. Oh my gosh. Right.
This is spot I just joined in. Just a trickler.
Probably second in currently my favourite in the series, because I think after the next one, I think Conquest is maybe my second favourite, but after the first one, but not by much.
I remember liking it best when I first saw them.
Yeah.
I remember everyone saying to me, Escape is the best of the sequels. I say everyone, I don't know who that would be, but like somebody or something said to me, Escape is the best of the sequels, whatever you think of the first one. And I remember watching it, thinking it was good, and then thinking Conquest was like far better. The reviews don't actually like bear that out.
No.
But I certainly really liked it.
Yeah, they certainly complement each other well.
They go together just like the first two do, without one feeling like a remake of the other, like the first two sort of do.
Exactly, yeah.
Yeah. I am looking forward to that. I was quite surprised. I know it's misleading because Rotten Tomatoes back in that period, or looking back on that period, would only have like 30, 40 reviews for a film of this age.
Yeah.
But there was a distinct downtick in the quality of reviews for the next film over this one. But that wasn't my memory. Admittedly, it's been a while though.
Hmm.
I really liked it.
This is not any Planet of the Apes related, but Dune's been moved back to October 1st, 2021.
Right. So they haven't moved Wonder Woman yet. Yet.
Yeah, Wonder Woman's on Christmas Day now.
Yeah, in the States, yeah. That would be.
But they'll have to move that again, surely.
They've got to move it. Well, nothing's going to be open.
Well, yeah.
You do worry how many years it's going to take. Assuming cinemas survive, which is a massive big if, I do wonder whether they would even approach the sort of box office they were doing before anyway.
Yeah.
So those films that have a sunk cost of like $250 million already, plus a bit of marketing here and there, you can leave it as long as you like, but I don't know if they're going to do the sort of box office we were expecting anyway.
Yeah,
I think that's the case now, actually. I think even if, you know, taking it out the situation that we're in, I think the thing studios aren't really considering is the fact that you aren't going to get the same box office that you did last year. You know, things have changed now, or at least it's going to take time to build up back to that. You know, regardless of COVID or whatever.
You're not gonna like have them shut until. Let's be really pessimistic and say like next August or something, and then open them and the first film out of the gate does 1.2 billion.
Yeah, yeah. It's, you know, I think people have already kind of like, I think
Tenet's already kind of shown that a little bit, hasn't it? I think it's kind of been a bit.
There's multiple factors though. Is that there is the idea that people rather stay at home. There's the idea of like, actually, well, people can't, whether they can or not. Do you know what I mean? With like,
they might not be able to. You don't know.
Yeah, but I think also the momentum of movie going's gone. People have got, I think people just gotten out of the habit, I think.
I was going to say, I did it as much as anybody who doesn't have a Cineworld card, in that people with Cineworld cards will go a couple hundred times a year, but I would go 50 to 80 times a year, sometimes less. The odd year it'd be 40 or something, but wouldn't be unusual in a given year that it was like high 50s, low 70s, something like that. And I missed it in that when Tenet came out, I went to it, I felt relieved to be back. But then infection started going up again and I was like, this isn't worth it. There's hardly anything coming out anyway. And I'm getting to the point that I do want it back, in that I don't want to watch Bond VOD. I really don't. But at the same time, there will come a point, because I'm out of the habit, and there'll come a point where it's just not what I do anymore.
That's the thing. I think as well, it's kind of, look at the... Maybe this is kind of the culmination of the era we're living in, of the domination of blockbusters, and this idea that it can survive on blockbusters. And maybe this is a kind of wake-up call to say that maybe that idea of them saving the industry is over.
I think as well that we have to remind ourselves that we're outliers. And yeah. What I mean by that is I've just said I go, let's say 50 times a year. It probably averages slightly more than that, but let's say 50. Chris will do more than that because he's got a Cine World card and he lives a bit more sort of urban than I do. I would have thought in the normal run of things. Becca probably does a little less. Charlie, I know you do. But we all probably go multiple times a year. The majority of people I work with barely go once a year. You know, they'll remember they went a couple of years ago, or they went last year for something, or went in March and I might go at Christmas for that. When you get
might go once like a month, Robbie, things like that, you know what I mean?
Well, not even that, but when you've got twats like Robbie Collins sort of conflating it with pubs, well, regular pub goers are regular pub goers.
He's gone down in my estimation.
It's just like firstly, it's not the same audience. The people that stand in a pub all night getting drunk are not necessarily the same people that are going to cinemas all the time. Maybe, but there's an overlap, but not completely the same. But the majority of people out there, i.e. not us, will come out for an event film or a film based on... So, like, you'll get people who went last year for, like, Downton Abbey because they like the TV show. They don't go to the cinema, but they like Downton Abbey. So their daughter will take them or something. You'll get people who...
It's like me trying to take my mum to go and see Downton Abbey.
Yeah, you'll get people who like a book. Like, go back a few years. My old boss hadn't been to the cinema in years, but he liked Captain Corelli's Mandolin, the book, so he went to see a film. There are other people who will go just for Bond, or just for Marvel, or just for whatever. And once you take out all of those, you're left with the people that will just go once a week to see something, and that's not enough to sustain the industry.
No.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of this idea again. First it was Tenet, then it was Bond, and everyone's kind of complaining at Eon for pulling it, where everyone in their right mind had thought they were going to pull it months before anyway. And
if anything, they were quick to pull it the first time. They were really slow this time.
Yeah,
they did it that time.
It was really weird because they did that marketing push with the music video and everything and the new trailer and stuff.
Yeah, they just pumped a few more million.
It makes me think.
I think that's what's confused, well, not confused people, but that's what's kind of so shocking. I mean, a lot of people did predict it first time round, but after that big marketing push.
It's this idea that Bond, like Tenet before it was supposed to do, is going to save it and make everything all right.
It's also the idea of cinema goers getting angry with Eon. I mean, by all means, get angry with Eon that they took so long in the development cycle that we were in COVID by the time it happened. But it was. So the idea that, like, what are you actually saying? You're saying people like Robbie Collins are basically, I'm frustrated because the industry I like and that I work in effectively because of being a reviewer and stuff is under threat. So why can't you, Eon, go and take one for the team? They've got one property, really. I know they make the odd other film, but they've got one property. Both of their distribution companies, Annapurna and Universal, have one film deals. So Universal aren't going to say, fine, we've signed this big deal with you, but by all means, take it to Netflix. Nor are they going to say, we'll put it out in the midst of a pandemic because we're trying to build a long-term relationship with you in that when the next Bond comes in, if that indeed happens, we would like to be what Sony was in this era and get like a 3 or 4 film deal. But we'll happily put it out and take a quarter of the money. It's not going to happen. Why should they take a hit for you?
The thing that sort of astounds me is that sort of... So like, you know, Eon, okay, you can understand Eon, fair enough, but then... You know, part of me's also thinking, well, this might be a Universal decision, not Eon's decision, as well. Because there's
but Eon would have the right. Universal would probably have the right to make that decision.
Yeah, so
they are responsible. They are effectively responsible for the box office of the film.
Yeah, so it's like, well, you might want to be sort of, you know, blaming Universal rather than Eon, but also, why don't you point at all the other studios? Because you know they weren't releasing stuff, so they weren't helping out as at all. You know, like, you know, what about Disney? You know, Disney could have released Mulan in cinemas as well as doing for Disney Plus and said, hey, you know what, here's, you got a choice. See it at home or see it in the theatres. Yeah. You know what I mean? Or, you know, or anyone else, everyone else, Warner Brothers, back down on Wonder Woman because they're not willing to take the hit. And so, ultimately, now we're back and we're cinemas closing down now. So,
but they're private companies trying to make money. You know, you can be as anti-capitalist as you like. That's what they're there for. They're not just going to go, well, fuck it, are they?
Oh yeah, I know.
And I heard that, you know, some areas Tenet was doing 80-90% of what they expected, and it's like, right, so they were 20% under then. Well, that's not good enough, is it? Bond aren't going to do that. Spectre already, I mean, whatever you think of Spectre, it already took about 300 million less than Skyfall anyway. And the series isn't quote-unquote hot at the moment anyway, because it hasn't done anything for so long. They need a good film and a good run and good word of mouth. Not everyone's shitting themselves about going. And blaming the consumer is cowardly. Blaming consumers for their own, like, cautions just because you feel safe or you want it to open,
well,
is cowardly.
It's like, you know, it's like even about COVID, that's just like, you know, if no one sees your movie, you know, it's like blaming people who, you know, oh, you know, didn't come out and see my movie, and blaming you. It's like, well, sorry, it doesn't work like that, does it? You know, can't blame people for not seeing something.
We don't owe them anything.
Yeah.
It's this idea as well that the UK is the most important market that they seem to have.
For Bond, it is.
For films.
You've got China, India.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the US is not looking great at the moment, is it?
No, exactly. I mean, yeah, literally there aren't many cinemas, if any, that are open at all. Especially, I think, New York and LA are probably the two biggest ones. Just blanket ban, basically.
I'm sure there are considerations in all of it I haven't thought of. I'm just a layman sat here talking. The idea that you blame the public for being cautious when we've had months of this thing could leave you long-term ill, don't risk your old folks with it.
No, especially if you're already long-term sick.
They opened Wetherspoons, and within about 4 weeks, 66 of their staff had gone down with it. Don't tell me it's fucking safe.
And then you have people as well saying, oh, buy memberships or whatever for cinemas and that kind of thing. And I saw someone saying, oh yeah, I just bought a membership to Curzon, which is like 350 quid or something, and in a time where so many people have been furloughed anyway.
He's like, well, if you can do it, great. Yeah. If not, you know, I think I've just seen the same as you as well. It's just like, you know, buy a gift voucher, buy a gift token, but it's like, are you going to be able to spend it? I mean, if you can do that, great.
I mean, it's all very well if you can, but there's this idea, there's this kind of pressure.
I feel that as well.
Members of the community on Twitter that to say you have to do this, or
it's either that they don't think about other people's finances or they think about their own sense of safety.
So I
know people who are perfectly nice people. They may or may not be listening to this, but there's one or two who I've seen, not bullying, they've been perfectly nice about it, but when people have expressed either fear, they've been a bit nothing to be frightened of, or when the person has expressed they're going to go, like I did, you get like, good on you. And it's like, but that's your sense of safety. You don't know what family I've got. You don't know what my work is.
You don't know everyone's circumstances, do you? It's difficult.
I mean, without spelling any of it out to our listeners, across the four of us, there are pre-existing conditions. You know, the higher risk conditions, without spelling out what those are.
Yeah.
And it's like, you don't know. You just don't know. And
you can't risk it. You really can't risk it.
Yeah, there's no way I would step into cinema at this time with two members of my family who are vulnerable people.
Exactly.
No way.
I was like, well, if you could do it like in a vacuum sealed.
But then you get, but people are getting pissed in pubs, and it's like, well, I'm not.
Yeah, just the mind boggles, the mind reader.
I'm not. So you're saying I should go to a cinema because people are getting pissed in pubs when I'm in neither category? Fuck off.
It just really does depend, doesn't it? Because I knew here sort of reports of, you know, people doing cinema visits, you know, which is fine. If that's what you want to do, that's fine. I'm not making any judgment. But very often it will be like you had, you know, one or two people in there, or, you know, confined environment.
I went to see it at about 5:30 on a Thursday night. So I was hardly in a peak screening time. But given that it was in in a town as well, you'd expect a few to pop in from work. I'd expect a handful in there.
Yeah,
but I was sat in there on my own, and I didn't spot anyone in the lobby either.
No, exactly. You had the place to yourself, didn't you, pretty much?
There would have been people in the odd other screen, I'm sure. But to all the world, it looked like they just opened to let me watch something.
Yeah, you had it all to yourself. So
Yeah, it was just, you know, that's quite nice.
It's nice when that happens, or if you've got, seem like, a handful of other people, or if you do have, you know, a bigger number, but they're very well spread out throughout the auditorium. That's fine. That really is fine.
But cases are going up. How serious it is, I don't know, but cases are going up, and we all know of people. A couple of us know a specific person who passed with it, and they passed at not a great age, and they were in reasonable health as well. They just happened to have a pre-existing condition. This is not something to be pissed about with for the sake of seeing a film. And a lot of it has been, well, you know, use it or lose it, and they're putting films on for you, but they're putting on, like, The Empire Strikes Back and Batman Begins and stuff, and it's like,
it's a good chance to see it on the big screen, but at the same time...
Why would I take a risk for that? It's like, well, I've owned copies of those films, whether I do it or not now, I'd almost have to look, but, like, what would be the point for the risk of that? With Bond, you go, well, you're only going to get one shot to see it on the sort of big screen for the first time when it's new. That doesn't necessarily mean you're going to go ahead and do that, but it puts a degree of, like, almost internal pressure in our minds. I certainly know myself and Becca would be a little bit like, I don't know if I want to go, but I can't. I almost physically can't not go.
It's one of those sort of things. For me personally, it would have been the film for me to tempt me back to the cinema, but I kind of thought, with everything on the rise, I was like, well, I'm kind of a little bit relieved that it's been moved. Obviously, I'm glad they pulled it,
and people are, stick it on video on demand, for God's sake. Well, firstly, they can't. Trust me, they cannot with their arrangements. But secondly, just fucking have some patience. You waited 5 fucking years, and it's made. It's not like after License to Kill, where we're saying, I hope somebody writes a Bond film one day. It's there. It's in the can. Just chill out. We'll do other things in the meantime.
It's kind of relief that it's been made and it's finished, and he's not going to. Well, if Fukunaga wants to go back and fiddle with it, that's fine. But it's you know, it's not kind of lapsing in development hell for years and years and years. It's been made. It's ready to go. It's just on pause right now. So I think that kind of brings.
At least we'll have something to watch to celebrate its the 60th anniversary. The 60th.
Yeah, I was gonna say that. That's the kind of thing. Now, will it be obviously come April next year? It's been postponed to November. And I can't like, oh, we'll just postpone November. It again to the anniversary. Why not?
I just think, oh god. I don't think it's easy to cancel the film without a slot to put it in. So they have to pick a slot. But I have no confidence it will hit that slot.
Yeah,
too early.
We don't know what's going to happen this time next year.
There won't be a widely rolled out vaccine by then, and it will be the first big film to go. And I don't think anyone wants to be first out of the gate.
No, I mean we're the only kind of area part only county in our area that's not on lockdown.
Sorry. You're the only area, what, in Wales?
We're the only county in South Wales that isn't in lockdown.
Yeah, I'm in a part of the country that's comparatively not too bad. Comparatively, in that the number of cases has quadrupled in about a week.
Yeah, I was like, look, it's comparatively, but
like Devon and Cornwall,
still on the rise.
I mean, I've lived in Liverpool, for example. Liverpool has... I'm guessing a little bit here without looking, but it probably only has like 75-80% of the population of Cornwall. I know it's urban, but just as a comparison. And it had something like 8 times the number of cases last time I looked. So there are places in this country that have it so much worse than us. But you can't do it regionally. That wouldn't be fair. And the other thing is... I don't think you know him, but there's a guy I'm friends with on Facebook who, we've all recorded with Pete D. Gaskell. I met this guy. This guy was best man at Pete D. Gaskell's wedding last year, Adam. And he went with his partner, Helen, to a Cineworld. And I can't remember which one it is. They live in Wetherby, which is quite near Harrogate. But I can't actually remember where the cinema was. But pick a town near there, and that's where they went to a Cineworld. And he put photos of it online. And he said, we came in here to see whatever it was. And he said, but we left without seeing it. And he showed the photos as to why. They'd done absolutely zero cleansing between the two screenings. There was popcorn strewn everywhere, half-drunk glasses, ripped up tickets. Not glasses, you know, the cups of drink. Ripped up tickets and everything. They'd done no cleaning. And he and Helen took one look at it and said, I'm leaving.
I thought, no.
And I said, make as much noise on both social media and even the local press as you can. So tell us it's safe. Yeah, it's safe if everybody does everything properly. That was not safe.
If they follow guidelines in place.
There were people with COVID that had been there, he would be at risk.
It's good that, you know, a lot of cinema chains, the ones that are kind of staying open or trying to be open as much as they can, are sort of, you know, trying to make a, as you say, make a big noise about how they've instituted these new guidelines. The staff are trying to do everything you can. Like if you go on the Odeon website, for example, they're updating a lot of it now, where a lot of the information is cinema specific. You'll see photos from the actual cinema itself, all the kind of things that they're doing, you know, to try and make it COVID safe, to try and provide some assurance for cinema goers, you know, that it is safe to come back. You can do it.
Chris,
yeah, something like that. If it was me, you know, and walked through a dirty cinema, I'd be like, hell no. No, I'd like point blank refuse.
But you haven't been, Becca, and I know Charlie won't. Chris, have you been back yet?
Oh, cinemas, yeah.
Yeah, I've only been once. I just went to Tenet.
Yeah, it's
and I felt safe.
It's been,
but I was
it's
on my
dead.
Own, of course I would.
Yeah, it's been dead, and I've had no issues. It's been absolutely fine. There's not been many people there, though, when you do go. But yeah, I've not had like much. I've not experienced that what you just described.
Nor have I, but I mean, I saw the photos and it was like, he's not made that up. That is absolutely shocking. I may even, while we're talking in a minute, see if I can still find a screenshot on his page or something, because I couldn't believe it. You know, there's laziness, and then there's like, you do remember we're in a pandemic, don't you?
Yeah, you don't always know kind of the reason. You know, it could be that perhaps they were extremely short staffed, but at the same time, I think especially, obviously, well, from time to time, you might expect to go into an auditorium that perhaps they haven't had time to clean between. But during a pandemic, you would expect extra layers of cleanliness in between.
Yeah, I don't want you harsh, but they should close if they don't have the staff.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, they should temporarily shut if they haven't got the staff to be able to do it. Or, you know, get a job, you know. I'll go in and do it.
I mean, he posts a fair bit, so I'm going to have to go back a little while. But while we're... Here we go. I can show you almost immediately. I'm just going to take a clipping. I'm going to use the snipping tool just to take, like... Hang on. No, not that. I'm going to see if I can just take a shot of the page, and I'll just show you. So I'll take two shots. I'll take one of what he said and then one of, like, the pictures. And just tell me... Sorry, this isn't great for listeners, but... While we're talking about it online, that's okay. Let me just find. So this is, I'm just sending you a screenshot of what he said, but then I'm going to take a screenshot of what he found when he walked in. And this is in the midst of a pandemic after they've been supposedly deep cleaned. And this is Cineworld that has closed down this week or will be closing down this week. Cineworld Bradford, I don't mind calling them out because we've got photographic evidence here.
Oh, yeah, it does go at rank.
Yeah.
Dirty floors, dirty strewn everywhere.
Yeah, that's ridiculous.
They just turned around and walked right out.
Also, why don't people take their filth with them?
Well, you are actually encouraged to leave your stuff by your seat so they can pick it up.
Okay, I wasn't aware of that, sorry. There isn't a Cineworld near me, unfortunately, so I don't know. If I take anything rubbish generally, I would take it with me. So
even so, when you look at how the public are at the moment about wearing masks or social distancing, you know that you can't really trust them to take
It does vary, doesn't it? Though it really does vary. Like some places you go and people are fine. Like I've just finished a temporal, and I think for the whole time I was there, I can count all the people that I served, you know, without a face covering, like a visor or a mask or otherwise. I can count them all on one hand. Like, it was very few people, and all us, you know, staff were quite good. We all kind of wore the protective gear and all the rest of it. And obviously, like, in a shop, it is quite difficult, but we, you know, tried to maintain it as best we could. And the provisions that they had as well in store were But they went above and beyond, as far as I'm concerned.
Broadly okay, but
yeah, but other places you go, and they just abandoned it completely, or they, you know, got staff to do the bare minimum or whatever, and you just think, oh my god, it makes it so much all the more difficult.
Well, it's the fact as well that you're supposed to wear a mask unless you're eating, and it's just like, well.
It's confusing, isn't it? It really is confusing.
Well, it's fine if you sit down at a table in a pub to eat and you're distanced from everybody else and you've cleaned your hands on the way in and everything else, because I have been places that are perfect. Unless this thing is seriously fucking airborne, then I think I was safe. But in a cinema, you can graze a box of popcorn for the whole 2 hours.
You could probably slip some in behind your face covering, yeah, depending.
Just take the covering off.
Or get one of those amazing ones with a zip on it or something.
I'm sat in there on my own and left it on. I was just like, well, that's the rule. I mean, it's just this whole thing of like, you're either able to open and do everything you can, or you're not. And it's like Charlie said, if you're short-staffed, which most cinemas are these days, you can't.
The non-skeleton staff.
You can't at the moment. And if you can't run a cinema without the value of concessions, but people are going to leave their masks off through the entire film, then you're not fit to open either. So I've got mixed feelings about it, because only in as much as now they've closed, I'm not convinced they'll come back.
No, I kind of feel, I really hope that, you know, this thing was just a temporary measure. I kind of really hope that's the case, really. I mean, because they are like one of the biggest, if not the biggest sort of chain, certainly in the UK as well. I think that wouldn't it? Nearest me is probably Southampton, I think, which closed a few years ago due to other issues. But yeah, I'm sorry to say there isn't one near me, unfortunately. But I think our nearest one is probably the Odeon, and obviously they reported today that they're sort of going to be opening like 3 days a week, sort of Friday, Saturday, Sunday, or, you know, very much on reduced hours for reduced staff. And it's just heartbreaking. It really is heartbreaking. I've got sort of friends who work there, and it's terrible, isn't it?
Actually, I suppose the scheme they've got to top up wages would deal with that. To some degree, it's just a, it's a shit show.
Yeah,
it's a mess.
If they'd be able to, you know, they might, hopefully they might be able to apply for it, or like Universal Credit, for example, or some other kind of scheme.
Well,
but there's, you know, there's
Cineworld staff found out about it from the press.
That's terrible. Oh my gosh, you know, to find out something like that, not even from your own employer, is just heart wrenching.
Yeah. That's probably leaking before Cineworld have actually made like a decision on that. Because you're not going to sort of start telling your staff stuff thinking you might do, but come to a decision on it yet. And then, so I think it kind of...
Yeah, it's all speculation, and then they'll make the announcement. But to find out something like that anyway, it's all circumstantial, but I just think it's not the best way to find out, is it?
No.
Absolutely not. So that's our thoughts on Escape from the Planet. Which, Chris, how knowledgeable are you on this?
Well, seeing that we spent a good chunk of it talking about the closing of cinemas, not a lot.
Well, yeah, I know a little bit about Youth of Joyce, but no, I'm not. So, Charlie, I'm presuming for the purposes of this section of the show, you now know nothing either.
No, a bit about George and Mildred, but otherwise, no.
Okay,
I didn't even know there was a spin-off film.
I don't know if I knew there was a film. There are a lot of those sorts of films, though, in the 70s.
There you go. That's one for your feature list, is the ITV sitcom spin-off.
Rising Damp, the film?
Yeah, Rising Damp. Was there a Man About the House film?
I think there may have been.
Dad's Army, maybe.
In 1974.
Dad's Army. There was a Steptoe and Son film.
Maybe a Hammer.
What else was
there? That's probably on the list anyway.
Yeah, it was Dad's Army films. Steptoe and Son. There was a there were several On the Bosses films. There are others. I'm struggling.
Carry on.
Porridge had a film. Porridge.
Yeah. I'm surprised there wasn't a Last of the Summer Wine one.
Well, they'd be too sexy for most audiences. bit graphic. All
maybe
that
because it was so long running. Maybe that's why. It just went on and on.
Are you being served?
Are you being served out of film?
Really?
That's this house.
Yeah.
There's clearly a trend in the 70s and
80s. I don't know what it is, right? Because... Bless This House and Man About the House show in the mornings. I've seen Bless This House on a few times as well.
I think some of them are probably on like Forces TV or those kind of channels.
Yeah. Leslie's House starred as Sid James, and his wife was played by Diana Coupland, who did the vocals for Underneath the Mango Tree.
Oh, that's a Bond connection.
On the not coming out of the water on the record. Yeah.
Please, sir. Steptoe and Son.
Yeah. I think there was Steptoe and Son Rides Again as well, there's a couple of them.
A sequel.
Till Death Do Us Part.
Oh, God.
And The Likely
But were
Lads.
They any good?
Whatever happened, The Likely Lads.
Let's rest aside.
The Likely Lads ran in two distinct phases because you had happened to The Likely Lads in the 70s, which was like better than the original version.
That was the one, yeah.
Yeah.
Had a film in 1976.
That was a good choice.
Mm. Rodney Buse was from down here somewhere, my mum knew.
Really?
Yeah, not well, but she knew him. He died not that long ago. Him and James Boland fell out and like never ever talked again.
Oh, that's so sad. That's really sad.
Yeah. So, anyway, we've taught you about sitcoms, Becca. What are you going to teach us?
About Escape from the Planet.
We're adding sitcom movies
the
to the list.
Emphasis is now on you. Fact us.
So we're adding all the westerns and sitcom movies to the list.
I doubt it somehow, but it's possible.
Listeners, if there are any films or series that we've not mentioned and you'd like us to review, drop us an email, expectustalk@gmail.com. If there's any sitcoms, films that you want to see.
Maybe you should do a layer cake commentary or something. As part of the Bond thing.
It is also starring Q, Ben Whishaw.
Yeah, because we can do his first Bond film before his last one. Which was
a kind of was a Bond film, kind of.
It was jarring because I never watched Our Friends in the North at the time, and I watched a tiny bit on BritBox the other day.
He looks so different as well.
Yeah, but he's talking in a Geordie accent, and it just doesn't suit him. It's not that it's bad; it might be bad. I don't know. I didn't really make a judgment on that, but it's like that is a strange voice coming out of Daniel Craig.
But then you watch Knives Out now, and it's kind of.
That's played comedic, though.
Of course,
I really did. But...
Yeah, me too.
So, anyway, we're continuing to teach Becca almost despite ourselves.
So, yes, I did struggle this week to find some fun facts, so apologies.
That's all right.
Sadly, not so fun facts.
We added the running time for you.
Yeah, we did. We made it a bit longer, so... But yeah, starting off with the not so fun fact, also, as you mentioned in the show, Salmoneau agreed to do this film because he hoped it would restart his career. But also he found the makeup process quite difficult, so his character was killed off. And this was one of his last roles prior to his death in the mid-1970s, 76. Fun fact number two, Ricardo Montalban's character gives a pendant or a medal of Surprises of Assisi to Zira's baby. And his co-star, Bradford Dillman, whose name I can't pronounce, played St. Francis in the titular 1961 film Francis of Assisi. Fun fact number three, all five Planet of the Apes films hit number one at the US box office when they were released. I think that's pretty cool. And some really long facts coming up, which I robbed from a wiki fandom site, so please bear with me. Fun fact number four, 20th Century Fox considered hiring either Gene Kelly of Hello Dolly fame or Gordon Douglas. Before settling on Don Taylor as a director, he was hired on the basis of his 1969 Western movie Five Man Army. But besides Arthur P. Jacobs, Roddy McDowall and Kim Hunter, other major veterans of the first film still on hand for the third film, also art director William Krieber, makeup genius John Chambers. He had his job role for this film, you know, he was still quite impactful, but he had a bit of an easier time, for example. Like in the first film, he had to create an entire ape city. In the second film, it was all underground, mutated New York City kind of disasterscape, I guess. But for here, obviously, they just had to use like the modern day LA cityscape, I guess. And fun fact number five, Charlie, you might be able to give us a bit of a, I don't know if you've read the comics, the non-canonical mini-series comic by DW Publishing called Planet of the Apes, The Primate Directive. You probably mentioned this previously. Explain the knowledge of being Earth's future and the time travel by having the crew of Enterprise and the Klingons working as behind the scenes. So that's kind of how they knew about time travel.
If
you go from the Planet of the Apes wiki fandom site, it literally says that was pretty much what it is. And it says, so they basically had the crew of the original series Enterprise and the Klingons as behind the scenes characters. for the events of Beneath the Planet of the Apes, where they left a tricorder behind, apparently. And so Milo, that allows him to pilot the spaceship that he, Cornelius, and Zira are in, and they travel to the Earth's past, apparently. It's all a bit wibbly-wobbly.
Then again, I remember when Marvel First Contact came out, Star Trek First Contact, and Marvel made a deal with Paramount to have Star Trek comics. And they had like a Star Trek Voyager comic and other things, and they did Star Trek X-Men, and it was the original series and the X-Men.
Okay, no, I didn't know about that.
Yeah.
Okay. Oh, and just while we're on the subject of films being moved, Fast 9's been moved as well. I only mentioned that because obviously we did the Fast and Furious series fairly recently, and we'd have probably done that weekend of release. That's moved to avoid Bond. I suspect they'll both move again, but it was going to be early April. It's now been moved to the end of May.
Positive.
Well, it's positive for Bond, actually. It's not in the way, because they have slightly different markets, to be fair, because Bond does pretty much not that much in China, for example. And, you know, Fast franchise is massive there, so it does vary. Anyway, as for social media, you can find me at ThePastorKid1976 on Twitter.
You can find me at Cinetronics, even though I barely tweet anyway, but you can also find me at Cinetronics and Cinetronics.co.uk for all the old episodes.
You can find me at Films on Wax on Twitter.
And you can find us on Twitter at Expect Us to Talk. You can also find us on Facebook, YouTube, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Stitcher, Podbean, and coming soon, Amazon Podcasts, and wherever you like to listen to us.
Way to put some quiet pressure on Chris there.
Yes, Chris, you can do it. Come on.
Amazon Podcasts as well, Chris.
Chris, come on, get on it. Get on
that. I mean, really, who uses Amazon, really, for the podcast?
Yeah. We want to support small independents, Chris.
Yes, generally visit cinematronics.co.uk. Chris's very own website, check us out from there. But wherever you listen to us, whatever platform you are on, whatever platform you draw your podcast from, don't forget just to rate us, review us, to like us, and share us. Helps us to attract more listeners and rank higher in the charts. Thank you very much.
And thank you for listening to this padded load of old bollocks.
Just a thought, what was the original release date back? Was it April this year?
It was announced in the original scheme of things for November, then it moved to February, and I think just as Fook and I came on board, but I think they were literally just working out his schedule.
Oh yeah, because Valentine's Day, Valentine's Day, April.
So would that make it directly a year? Because I was trying to think what the original...
Yeah, because it depends how you count it, because people say, oh, people are forgetting the delays before that. But to be fair, the one that was announced just after Fukunaga came on board was April. It's a year delay, at least. But of course, from the original announcement of November 19, which we thought was a long time then. I mean, Christ, Craig said in August 17 he was coming back. It's hardly his fault at this point. Christ, I mean, Brosnan was announced about 15 months before GoldenEye came out. You know what I mean?
It's a long old process, isn't it?
It is, really, but then they keep hiring shit writers. Anyway, on that cheery note, I don't know if there's more substance in next week's show or not, because I've only seen it once, but we will then be covering the next in the series, which means Becca.
Do you expect to talk? We'll return with Conquest of the Planet of the Apes.